drive you insane. All I do is fight my brain. What have I got and what can I gain? All I want to say, it will stay the same. Okay, that was Jesse Hector, the Gorillaz, out of my brain. Tonight we've got Jesse Hector in the studio. Hi, Jesse.
Hello, nice to meet you.
Okay, yeah, so tell us all about it.
What Sam from the Out of My Brain single?
Yeah, well, there's a RPM Records are putting a new compilation album out.
Yeah, that record was originally on Message to the World, which is our LP that was done in 1978. But they're putting an old load of tracks together right through the years, which is like 1961 and some stuff in 1968 and 9 and right through up until the later stuff in the 90s. So they've added a good compilation together of all the stuff, and that's one of the tracks that's coming on out on the album. And that's basically it. You know, Out of My Brain was one of our songs at that time. You know,
yeah, we love it.
And it's album, a bit of plug. It's coming out at the end of March. It's called Gorilla Garage. 22 tracks. Yeah, from 1961 up until 95.
About 95. 96.
Jesse at the Gatecrashers. Great album.
What's the story about the Two Eyes Club then?
Well, the Two Eyes was a lucky gig actually, because we were a skiffle band really. I mean, I started playing guitar when I was about 6 years old, and it was too big for me. You know, I used to lean over it and play. Well, by the time I got to 9 or 10, I could handle a few chords. You know, so we would play around as a young skiffle band way back in the early 58 period, 57, 58, 59, through those years. So what happened now was we'd play these pubs, and sometimes we'd get thrown out because we weren't allowed to go in because we were too young, you know. But we'd play out on the comb. We had a massive following, you know. It was quite weird because you'd come along, a lot of them would stand in the street, and the police would try and move us on a bit because it would cause quite a lot of problems in the street sometimes, with a lot of crowds in the street. So it was quite funny. And a guy approached me, a guy called Colin at the time, said to me, I know people, he said, and not a lot of people, but I know a couple of people, and one works at Two Eyes. Would you like to try a gig down? I said, yeah. So we all went down there, and I think it's very early in the 59 period, so we started to play down there, and it was quite a good experience. And that was, got a couple of gigs where we played around the West End and that, you know. So that's how it went from there. And mainly it was a skiffle band, you know, for just doing pubs and so forth, you know.
Is that it?
Oh,
no,
it's over there. We're going to play another track, yeah?
Okay.
You got a particular track you want to hear?
Maybe play the really early one. Was that, do you want to play that or not?
What about the one of the later ones?
Okay.
Something like Carolina.
Carolina,
yeah.
First track?
Yeah.
First track on it.
This is 1995. Came out as a single.
Came out as a single in a magazine or something like that. No.
Is that right? It
was recorded at Toe Rag Studios?
Yeah, Toe Rag was recorded, yeah.
Great sound.
That was Carolina, Jesse Hector, and the Gatecrashers. Yeah, pulled about 95.
Yeah, yeah, that was a quick one take we did in Tote Rag. Yeah, we done about half a dozen tracks, and I think like one of them, or two, even a couple of them, were just the first track. We just went into jam, and they said, "We've captured the sound." And we said, "Oh, leave it then. Let's leave it like that." We never went out and done anything else to it, you know.
Was Liam, where was he wearing his lab coat?
Liam, I can't remember at the moment. Great guy, Liam. He's going to be very big, I'm sure. He's on the right road to the right stuff he's doing, you know.
We're going to play the Craig in a minute. I must be mad, because you're saying you knew them.
I didn't know them, but what happened was is that they signed to Larry Page. Well, they came in to make a single. Now, Larry was looking for names, and that was in the balance. No one ever said anything. But my mate was Adrian's brother, was a very groovy-looking guy with all the little glasses, and you know, it was the right look at the right time, really looked the business, you know, and we were all fashionable people. So he came in and I said, "Well, you know, what does he do?" I said, "Well, he's not in the band, but if he's just looking after some of our business and things like that, you know." And he said, "What's your name?" I said, "Craig." He said, "Oh, Craig." He said, "We need a good name." And that was the end of it. I didn't know what he meant by "I need a good name." You know, nothing was said. But later on, all that happened was the single "I Must Be Mad" came out as the Craig. I can't say for definite, but I think that could be where he got the name from. But it might not be. So we're not saying 100%, but it could very well be. As well.
All right, yeah, let's hear it.
Tell us we should.
The Clique, wow. Jesse Hector on guitar, yeah?
Helped him out, yes, yes. I played around with them on various bits and pieces. Great friends of mine, yes.
Okay, that's Larry Page production, yeah?
Larry Page producer, record,
yeah. Intro, what's that all about?
What, the guitar? Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, that was just an idea that came up at the time in the studio. No one really planned anything, I mean.
And then he used it on.
Then he used it again, didn't he?
It seems as though they took it when we'd gone out the door. They used it for Wild Thing. Yeah, I mean, possibly the Twogs had thought it was a good idea. So they. I even sometimes think, well, it might have been the same take. But anyway, rock and roll, no rules.
All right. So what are we going to play next?
What are we going to play next? We've got the new. New Charlie Feathers box set in the house, yeah, it's just come out last week.
Wow.
Sounds at Swing Records in Inverness Street. We're going to play a track off that, yeah?
Well, you pick the tune and you slap the bass. I play the rhythm and I set the pace. But we gotta get with it, got no time to wait. Well, we gotta get with it, we're gonna rock it tonight. We gotta get with it. We gotta get with it, get some love tonight, get a winner. We gotta get with it. Everything's all right. We gotta get with it. Gonna rock it tonight. Rock it tonight. We gotta get with it. Everything's all right. We gotta get with it. Gonna rock it tonight.
Charlie Feathers, new box set out. Get it while you can. Jesse.
Yeah, Charlie Feathers, amazing, yes. big part of what I liked, Sonny Burgess, Charlie Feathers, Warren Smith, all that stuff. One of my favourite rockabilly records is Oi Hoi by Clyde Stacey and the Nightcaps. That's really one of my favourite all-time greats. I remember I used to do a thing around the early 60s and Mike Raven would be around, and once he made me this incredible tape, and on it was Red Hot, Warren Smith, Ubangie Stomp, and all that stuff like that. And it was amazing. He said to me, if you can learn these songs, he said, you'll blow everyone away. So we did learn a few, not the gig that night. We caused a bloody riot. The place went mental. They'd never heard these ones at that time. It had never been known in England where they come from. So we was pretty early in there on the rockabilly stuff, you know. It was great because it was so fresh and brand new. And people would just come up to you and say, what's that one you done, Jill? He said, oh, Tongue Tied Jill. That's a Charlie Foote or something like that. Would blow their minds, you know. I'd never heard that stuff, you know. So, quite an interesting period back then, you know.
Mike Raven, because he was, wasn't he like sort of. Sort of like a Hammer... It was a Hammer horror film,
He was like an occult man, yeah. He was into the occult very much, yeah. Great character for me. Boy, did he help me a lot. He gave me some incredible gigs, and I remember once we did the Railway Hotel in Nurham Worldstone, and it was jam-packed, and even in the street, and all across the road. Even the cars couldn't go through the street. And it was amazing gigs. So they had the windows open, and everyone was, you know, going really getting into it. And he put me on some fantastic gigs and some fantastic music. I must have learned quite a bit there early. And later on, I mean, I picked up on Breathless Dan Coffey very early, and I think we were going up to Dan's Rock House in Wales in around about 64, 65, then periods, quite early. And Dan had got all this stuff all over the bloody place, and we were just laying on the floor for days and days and days. And fuck, have you heard this one? Have you heard that one? Have you heard this? What's that one? Well, Jesus, what's that? Boom, boom. Cracking records, you know, all from the Sun's studios and all from people like Sam Phillips had given him the records. I said, Sam Phillips? He said, well, I'll go over there. I said, Jesus Christ, Dan, you know. And we, you know, when I'd leave there, I'd come away with a copy of Movie Mag EP, which is like Carl Perkins. I mean, that EP's worth a grand now, and you know, maybe a little bit less, but not much. But I'd come away and I'd spend about a quid there, and I'd come away with a Movie Mag, a Ubangie Stomp, and possibly an Elvis Sun record if we wanted for a couple of quid. You know, it's amazing, isn't it? I better not say this too loud. I mean, I didn't keep any of them. I sold them all, but we did have them at the time.
I saw a copy of Movie Mag that was going like £500 in Barnes.
£500, sorry. Yeah. But was that a mint? Was that a brand new one?
Yeah, well, no, it was the one I actually played it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, then you can imagine what a brand new one would go for, Rosco, wouldn't it? I mean, with that lovely EP cover. Yeah, I mean, I paid something like... out of a pound in old money today would be 25 pence for my copy.
Wow.
Off a Dan, you know.
Let's hear it then, Ubangie Stomp.
Well, I rock over Italy and I rock over Spain. I rock in Memphis, it was all the same. Till I rock through Africa and I roll off the ship and seen them natives doing an odd-looking skip. I parted the weeds and looked over the swamp and I seen them cats doing the Ubangie Stomp. Ubangie Stomp with the rock and roll beats anything that's ever been told. The Ubangie Stomp, the Ubangie style, when it hits, it drives a cool cat wild. Chief, he invited me in. He said, hey, big jam session about to begin. He handed me a trunk from I picked up that beat. That crazy thing sent shivers to my feet. I rocked and I rolled and I skipped with a smile. I done the Ubangie Stomp, Ubangie style. Rocking time where the chief's daughter made. I was making good time and getting in the know when Captain said, son, we gotta go. I said, that's all right, you go right ahead. I'm on a Ubangie Stomp till I roll over dead.